Welcome back to our community. Susie Thomas visiting with Dan Gregory from Restore Addiction Recovery. Dan, since this is just now getting off the ground, where will these men come from?
I would imagine a lot of them will come from Stark and Portage and Summit counties, but I also think people will come from all over Ohio and Pittsburgh, and I think we'll draw people candidly from many, many different states just because of the design elements of the program.
Mm-hmm. Who would this be? We're talking about somebody now who's probably not able to hold a job. Homeless individual? Tell me who we're describing here as far as the gentlemen that are going to be your first participants.
So if we look at sort of the target that we're going after, and if you think of people that struggle with addiction as a big, you know, pie, mm-hmm. really one of the larger segments is men with the ability to work. So that's what we're targeting. Okay. And so we want to make sure that as we target those men, we give them the best chance of succeeding. So we want to make sure they can meet those requirements. But really, there's going to be a wide variety. It's changed over the years. We've seen the demographics change. We see it going younger and older. So it's really, you'll have younger 19, 20, 21-year-olds who have struggled through high school with addiction. You'll have athletes in that same age group that might have gotten an injury in high school and were prescribed opiates, and it was just a very addictive problem for them. So you'll see that age group that really it became a huge problem where they couldn't hold down a job, couldn't go to college. You'll get a lot of that kind of person coming, but you also get people that have just struggled. They'll do well for a few months and then really struggle again. So there'll be a range of people, I would imagine, from early 20s through mid to late 40s. And there'll be outliers in each side, but that's probably the range of men.
Okay, that'll be right in there. There will be probably a number of people because the statistics are showing us how many people are addicted to opiates because of a prescription drug.
Mm-hmm.
That it was just, perhaps overprescribed or for whatever reason. You take something long enough, you become dependent upon mm-hmm. it, and then really hard to stop. So, yeah, we have so many addicts, no fault of their own. And as you said, some of the athletes have experienced that as well. So, but primarily, we're not looking for the sweet little old lady who got addicted to her painkillers. This is going to be primarily as you're starting up for men with the ability to work.
Right. But keep in mind, a lot of those men will have come out of the trades because,
yes.
Especially if you work in a role that requires you to have a lot of physical activity, you're only paid when you're working. So to your point that you mentioned earlier, Susie, if you have a back injury and you're prescribed opiates and that's what makes you feel better and allows you to go back to work, it's understandable that you struggle with that addiction because you if you don't take them, you don't feel good. And if you don't feel good, you don't go to work. So
yes.
We understand that a lot of it, as you said, comes from that type of activity. And we also know that different people respond to different medications in different ways. You and I do as well. So no one knows how they're going to respond to an opiate until take one.
That's
so for some people, opiates aren't even very effective painkillers. For other mm-hmm. people, they take that opiate and it really impacts them, and it mm-hmm. becomes much more addictive to some than others.
Mm-hmm. We're all made differently. We're all
yes.
wired a little bit differently. Where are you going to be located?
So we're going to be located in Lakemore, Ohio, and it is the site of the original Edwin Shaw facility that was built, I believe, Susie, in 1910 to handle the tuberculosis crisis. And it was strategically located because it was a good spot for all three counties, Stark, Portage, and Summit, where they could service all three counties.
Yes.
And so I think that was built in 1910, and then an additional hospital was built, and then a lot of other buildings were built around that. That has recently, in the last couple of years, been torn down. So all the facilities are down, and Summit County provided 18 and a half acres for restorative recovery. And our location will be really right on top of the original Edwin Shaw location. So wow. We're sort of thrilled to provide hope and healing back to that area.
Right. It's almost like that's been hallowed ground, almost
yes.
set aside for hope and healing.
Right.
It's quite an undertaking for a church to build something like this. I know it takes funds. How are you funded?
So Christ Community Chapel was really what I would call the initiator. Other churches have been involved. So Grace Bath, Grace Norton has been involved. Other churches have also stepped up and said we would like to play a key role. So we're still working with a lot of other churches that know this is a problem, that would like to be involved.
Mm-hmm.
But also there's been a lot of individuals that this has impacted, which you can well imagine, that really want to see something like this happen. So a lot of individual donations from, you know, as small as, you know, $10 or $20 up to $300,000 has been just amazingly gifted to this.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not a small facility. It's gonna hold 75 people.
Wow.
So it's going to be large, and the builder, which is Premier Development Partners, has agreed to build this without any commissions or any fees. So they're literally building this. They're not going to make a penny on this, and they're really working with the subcontractors who have just had such a great outpouring to also provide a lot of services. So
wow.
We're blessed that the building itself would not be able to be built the way we designed it, at the cost we would like to have it, if it wasn't for the supportive help of so many.
My goodness. How about staffing it? Are these going to be professionals who volunteer their time, or are these going to be paid staff working with these people 12 months each?
Yeah, there'll be a combination of both.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have, in our paid staff, we'll have licensed people that will be involved on a salary level. We've partnered with Emerge Counseling, which is in
yes.
Summit County. They're a phenomenal organization.
Yeah.
Emerge is going to really provide guidance through the entire process for each man that comes in. So each person will have an individual development plan based on their needs, and licensed Emerge Christian counselors will be involved in all that. But there will be many, many needs for people like mentors. So each man will have an assigned mentor. And so there'll be a lot of needs for people that want to just come alongside us and volunteer.
Many shelters, I've seen some people say, I can't stay there because they have rules.
Mm-hmm.
So I imagine there's going to have to be some kind of a community agreement that each of these gentlemen signs or abides by in order to go through the program, but to be affected and impacted by your ministry. Can you touch on that a bit? What will be required?
Well, the requirements is that, obviously, if you're coming to the program, your desire is to be drug-free.
Right.
So we understand the men have, you know, partaken in a lot of drugs before they've come, and there'll be men that will come to orientation having taken drugs in the parking lot just to get through the orientation, and we understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But the rule moving forward will be that will be the last time you'll do drugs. So it'll be a drug-free facility, and it will be tobacco-free, because we really feel that we want to make sure we help people with lifelong maintenance, and we think that
mm-hmm.
chewing tobacco and smoking is probably not a good lifelong maintenance tool, and not a good tool to combat other drugs. So our goal is to be tobacco-free, alcohol-free, and drug-free. And the other rules of the program are less rules and more what you'd almost have in a family. You got to be able to get along with people.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to help out. So when I mentioned earlier, we won't have somebody, a paid staff or a volunteer, doing dishes. The men in the program will do the dishes. And as you move from phase one to phase two, it's not just the time to move from phase one to phase two. It's your attitude. Have you understood that you're there to serve, not just to get?
Will they attend a regular Bible study? Will they have kind of classes? I know they're going to be training for job training and so forth. But getting back into the Christian nourishing of
sure.
them, what will be happening there?
Well, it'll depend on the phase of the program they're in.
Mm-hmm.
But in that first phase where they're not working, there'll be a significant amount of just time in God's Word, time letting God's word flow over them, reflecting on that, teaching them to pray, if they don't know how to pray. Teaching them what consistent Bible study looks like. We'll be spending that first month. But then really throughout the whole program, we're going to teach the men, no matter how busy you get and how you gauge your schedule, you know, having consistent time in God's Word and prayer is important, as is community.
Yes.
So the idea is that we're preparing them all through the program for what real life looks like. And we've always said, it's interesting for most of us, real life is cooking, cleaning, and working. And so we want the men to feel that busyness, but then still be able to find time to pray and study God's Word, which is what we're all challenged to do as well.
Isn't that just everyone? Yeah.
That's sort of just everyone,
sums
right?
Sums it up, doesn't it?
It is.
Hearing you talk about this, this sounds like a program that has been going on for decades. This has been so thought out. Tell me about the preparation for this, because I can't imagine, down to all these details, that how much work went into that, and probably, I'm guessing, consulting with other people who work in the same area.
Yes, and Susie, I think that's the key, is that we've been able to connect with so many other organizations that feel the need to help, but primarily that organization I mentioned before down in Columbus called The Refuge has been so open-handed and has been able to really share with us the curriculum they're going to use and how they do it. So really, much of this has been helped by others. And we're creating a playbook here that we want to give away as well. The idea is that it's obviously hard to start something like this, but the first one's much more difficult than the second. So our goal is to develop a playbook for others to be able to follow.
So it just seems like something that it would be duplicatable for other communities to follow suit.
Absolutely.
And set this, this could be a national thing.
Absolutely. Our goal is to make this very easy, and we're still trying to figure out how best can we help other people implement it once we're up and running.
Is there a website where people could go for more information?
Sure. They can go to restoreaddictionrecovery.com.
That's it.
On that website, you can see, I think, everything you want to see. You can also see, I think it was just put up today, an amazing video that walks you through the building that's narrated so you understand exactly what we're trying to build.
Awesome. And we wish you all the best for your groundbreaking taking place in April. It's Restore Addiction Recovery. Dan Gregory, thank you for what you're bringing to our community.
Thank you, Susie.